Servus.
Hey Lee, look what I found on the hill.
My guess is it's an animal bone and there just happened to be...
Some other animal shot it.
Yeah.
Hi Mom. I was thinking about coming down.
I just need a break.
I'll do the taxes.
No, but see,
I'll
and do then the do you see what happens?
I'm sorry.
And then... Why isn't Daddy?
Sometimes mommies want daddies to pitch in, and if you don't, mommy comes after you and goes rawr. So daddy is at home doing his homework.
I guess first, before we dive in deep, I gotta know why you didn't write more dance sequences for Sam Rockwell.
Because I am a terrible writer. Now, you know, this movie, the writing of it was, it's just an outline. So Joe and I did a movie called Drinking Buddies, which we love to do together. And we wanted to make a somewhat follow-up movie about, you know, obviously different characters and different age, but the same tone and feeling. And that dance sequence just happened. That was part of when the night gets crazy and the party gets out of hand, and Sam's an incredible dancer.
Yeah.
And so he and Anna wanted to dance.
The foot dance, yeah, that's good. But you have such a great cast here, and as obviously everybody's probably pointed out to you, but they're the kind of people that I feel like I could chill and just have a beer and talk to.
Totally.
And so was it like that? Was it relatively easy to bring everybody on board to say, hey, we're just going to film a hangout?
Kind of, yes and no. It was a hand-picked group of people who could create that vibe. Mm-hmm. So when you're shooting a movie, even though it looks like a fun party, it's not, because you always have, each scene has a goal, and you've got to accomplish it. But nobody in this movie was thrown on us by some studio or some numbers guy. Everybody in this movie was exactly who we kind of wanted, and we were fortunate they came in, because everybody has a certain, you know, power as an actor and a vibe about them that we thought just worked with the tone of this movie.
Yeah.
Ain't shady, baby, I'm hot.
This is very strange.
We would start construction.
Get ready. We are going to have a fun Saturday night.
I found this, and then I found that, man.
Well, let's keep digging.
We're going to just sort of hang here.
I'm in.
Come on, it's going to be fun.
I actually miss seeing you, man.
It's crazy having a kid.
No sleep. No sleep. No sleep.
Also, there's a person.
I gotta sleep.
Probably one of my favorite elements of the film was this incorporation of the book, The Passionate Marriage.
Right.
And so I found it very interesting that it kind of followed Lee,
Rosemary
DeWitt's character throughout the film. And so it kind of added like this ironic dimension to the film, as well as like kind of subtle humor.
Totally.
To this story of like a struggling marriage. And so was it you or Joe who
found the book? No, that's Joe. That was something that really meant a lot to Joe, and he thought it also it'd be really funny to keep popping it in. But the way that we actually wrote this story is we broke the story in, obviously, in two different A stories, Rose's story and my story. Mm-hmm. And I was very involved in the writing of my story, and Joe and Rosemary were actually really involved in the writing of that story. Mm-hmm. So that book was a book that was given to Joe Swanberg by the director, Lynn Shelton.
Really?
The great Lynn Shelton. And she gave it to him for his marriage. And so he thought it'd be really funny to keep popping it in.
Yeah, that's cool. But like, I feel like those kind of books are for people who are just like trying to look for answers to life's biggest problems.
That's
so
right.
Is there a book for you guys that where you kind of found like the answer to life's problems the most?
Cat's Cradle by Kurt Vonnegut was a game changing book for me. Yeah. Like how some kind like a bandit, you know, it was such a funny and satirical book and so ahead of its time that like I feel like it informed my sense of humor a lot, because I read it when I was like 19. At a very formative age, so yeah, kind of. That's my favorite book, so
yeah,
that was pretty big for me.
And not for life, but for my work, a book called "The Things They Carried" by Tim O'Brien, mm-hmm. which is constantly playing with what is real and what isn't real. And there's a great bit in there of like how to tell a true war story, which is, you know, the idea that just because something didn't happen doesn't mean it's not real if the emotions are real, and even the special thanks are to a fake platoon that you don't realize until after. And in my work, I like creating things that feel very real and feel like, well, that's just him with those people.
Yeah.
But there's a conversation before of what we're trying to convey, and that book to me was when I read that, I thought, well, I know this is kind of what I want to do.
Right.
Nothing had hit home as much as that one did.
Waiting to get my life back. When did it come back?
married?
Mm-hmm.
Since when?
Just a license plate.
Wow.
Yeah, there's garbage in the ground. Stop, if you dig far enough, you'll find a landfill.
Wow. Right now, and I don't even know you.
That's very liberating.
Your character in the film is like, I guess it kind of hints at that we live in this Peter Pan generation where we really don't want to grow up. We don't want to do our taxes.
That's right.
We don't want to deal with the responsibilities of a kid or or a marriage.
But we're able to like live our lives and function.
Yeah.
So it's not another generation where it's not our parents' generation in that you can do a lot of this Peter Pan shit and still get by.
Yeah.
And still do pretty well.
Yeah.
So that was something this character got involved in, and then I think the mortality of the body and his life starts kicking in, because there is a certain point where you can live like that for a while, but then if your bills keep piling up and work doesn't start happening. Mm-hmm.
You were also, I mean, this is from an outside perspective, but your character was also kind of like being, not like forced, but you know, she was talking about when you sent him to private school, and you had like the sense of pride, which I thought was like something pretty interesting, because she's from a rich family, and you're... I don't know, maybe from like a middle class family, but like you were pretty steadfast about staying in that middle class world.
That's right.
And so you're living in this house, which is a fantasy. So
totally.
I thought that was really interesting.
Yeah. But was there a moment that in your life where you realized, okay, I guess now I'm an adult? Because there are a lot of those adult moments.
Yeah. In my personal life, it was when I was about 20, 21 years old, and I realized I was dead broke. And there was no money coming, and there was no safety net. So I thought, well, I could just keep struggling and day jobbing it, but I've got to find a way where I could make the kind of money that I need to live, and how am I going to do that?
Yeah. For you?
He choked on an Arby's sandwich this
That's
morning.
That's true. It was, I think, this morning when I was having Arby's Bros. Big Montana.
And he goes, Jesus, I'm a man, because a boy would have died with the amount of roast beef.
I mean, like I had a real kind of Jesus moment.
And then a couple minutes later, he just kept eating the roast beef.
Yeah.
And then goes, back to being a boy.
Absolutely. I'm not going to let a perfectly good sandwich go to waste. Ever.
Or the three next to it. Or the fries. Or the bag of chips.
He's right there. I'll never do.
And lastly, like, have you learned, like, what is the secret to an everlasting relationship?
Stevers?
Oh my God. It is just pushing all your emotions down and just not being honest with yourself. I think, and just kind of doing it. Just saying, like, I go around this world once, should probably just be with one woman forever. Seems like a logical thing. So, yeah. Just follow the herd. Honestly.
Best answer ever, man.
Yeah, that's a lot better than when I asked the same thing to Mark Duplass for The One I Love, and he said, just expecting that your significant other like will expect that you will only do about 70% of the things that they ask you to do.
Yeah, that's pretty great.
Yeah.
That's
right.
Yeah. I'm going to combine Mark's and Steve's.
Yeah.
Merge those together. I'm somewhere in there.
I love my wife, though.
Good answer.
Being in love, what is that? Getting what you want, or is it giving somebody what they want?
Do you not yourself right now?
I found something!
I feel like you're...
Woo!
What do you think is going on here?
If you don't want to dig, how about some hookers?
No, no, it's a sort of an illogical jump you just made. Bigger, butter, leany, meany, money, mo, and flower.